left out in the first line under the town center zone. Mr. Emery explained that this was quite an elaborate zoning rewrite.
Could you tell me which page?
First page, middle of the page one.
Oh, okay.
Strike A and include was, and otherwise I thought they were fine.
Any other corrections or comments? Mr. Edsel?
Mr. Chairman, the first page, third paragraph on the town center zone, starting the second half of the second sentence. Maybe I just missed the whole meaning of the sentence here, but it says, it'll be easier for people who are essentially permitted to be able to do their business. Does that make sense to other people? Am I not just misreading the sentence?
I thought it was awkward, but that it could be possibly what Tom said, so.
Well, that makes more sense.
I don't mean to.
Yeah, I'm sure that's exactly what he said.
Well, then it should say, he said confusingly.
He said in order to mix up the board. My last, page four, fifth paragraph.
Would you want to just strike essentially? Would that help your meaning?
If other people understand what this means, that's fine with me. I just.
Page four.
Page four. Fifth paragraph, starting Mr. Edsel, pointed out that this does not affect the businesses there now. It is for future planning. Just like Mr. Emery, I probably said that, but neither one of those sentences makes a lot of. I would just strike from the word pointed out through the word planning. I don't know that that adds a lot. I just said Mr. Edsel proposed a motion. It really doesn't add anything to the minutes.
No objection.
Which is true, but what I say a lot. That's it.
Oh, but your presence is always helpful. Any other comments? Your motion? Mr. Edsel?
I move the minutes approved as amended.
Second.
Second. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passed unanimously. Mr. Carter is still an associate member. You're a voting member.
Mm-hmm.
That's correct. It's Ms. McKay that's an associate member. Since we have all active members here now. Okay. There's some confusion there. Ms. McKay used to be a voting member and has replaced an associate member, and at the same time we're in the throes of getting rid of the associate member status. So, with that, we move to items of correspondence. Again, quite a lengthy list. We have a letter from, and due to the length of the list, those items that deal directly with applications we'll discuss with the appropriate application under the appropriate business heading. Otherwise, I'll simply list the correspondence. We have a letter from S. McCall regarding the town center, a memorandum from the fire chief regarding Linnell public access waiver, a letter from C. Gorman regarding the accessory dwelling units, a letter from Mr. Balder, again, regarding the accessory dwelling units, a recommendation to the town council regarding associate members, and that recommendation was that we remove the associate member status and make all members, seven members, active voting members. A recommendation to the town council regarding the town center zone, that was presented to the town council last night and referred to the next public meeting in January. The Planning Commissioner's Journal of Fall 1994, the Environmental and Development September of 94, Currents Newsletter Fall 94 regarding Casco Estuary Project, letter number two from C. Gorm regarding the accessory dwelling units, the Jelen Appeals Finding of Fact, a letter from the town manager regarding the Jelen boat ramp, a letter from T. Holt regarding accessory dwelling units, a letter from the town attorney regarding Dobie, and a memorandum from the code enforcement officer regarding the Dobie application. I believe that's all the items. And in addition, left on our table this evening is a map of see, what's the name of this project? Newback. The Wells Road subdivision project, in order for us to have a site walk on Saturday morning at 9:00, Saturday the 19th, I want to be very clear once again that this is not a formal application before the board. We received a sketch plan simply to allow us to see elements on the site and to get the neighbors and the town and the planning board involved in this process as early as possible. Additionally, we have a letter regarding accessory dwelling units.
Paul Goldman.
From Mr. Goldman. Quite a lengthy letter. With attachments. Thought I was in the wrong room again. This attachment was to Council Creelman, but obviously it's a historic document. Must be a happy individual. Mr. Creelman, that is, with the recent elections. A letter to Mr. Emery, the chairman, from residents at McKinney Point regarding the Dobie application. A letter from John and Karen Atwood regarding the Wells Road subdivision. The meeting notes from the Office of the Superintendent of Schools regarding the Cape Elizabeth building project. And a zoning wake-up call memorandum. A letter from Edith N. Netter and Associates, Boston, Massachusetts.
Does that complete the list?
Perfect. With that, we'll move ahead. First item on tonight's agenda is a Ram Head subdivision wetlands permit, alteration permit extension request by Shaw Sprague for 1-year extension of the wetland alteration permit. Could you give us a little background on this one?
Sure. The applicant is here tonight. And the planning board a year ago, November 16th, approved the Ram's Head subdivision, granted subdivision approval, public access waiver, and a wetlands alteration permit. Subdivision approval has to be recorded within 90 days, and there's no expiration beyond that point. There's no expiration for a public access waiver, but there is in the ordinance a requirement that work must be substantially complete within a year, or the wetlands alteration permit expires, and the applicant is required to come back and reapply for the whole permit. The applicant is requesting a 1-year extension of that, and that would be based on the current approval that you have.
The applicant is here. Would you please come up and make a brief presentation to the board? You may want to turn that just slightly to your right, left for the home viewers. The camera is, the Postal Service camera is up there. The other one is, no, actually the camera's up there now.
Is that?
That's
okay.
It, yes.
Can you see it?
Yes, I can. As well as I can see it.
My name is Rick Chenet, and I'm a lawyer with Drummond Woodsman at Mann in Portland, and I represent Mr. Sprague, who, as Maureen pointed out, is here, along with Brad here of Land Use Consultants. The area we're talking about is that stretch of the road shown in dark green. The reason Mr. Sprague has been delayed in commencing the work is really two reasons. One, the Sprague Corporation filed suit against Mr. Sprague about a year ago, seeking to establish prescriptive rights across the road that extends down in the area of the wetlands work, and that suit was only recently settled. Secondly, Mr. Sprague has been negotiating the sale of the entire project, and we do not want to proceed with the work in the event the new owner might choose to not go ahead or perhaps go ahead in a different manner. So for those reasons, we're seeking the extension tonight. Thank you.
Any questions or comments on the board at this point? Do I hear a motion?
Motion for the board to consider. It ordered that based on the information presented in the plans previously approved, the request of Shaw Sprague for a 1-year extension of the wetlands alteration permit for the Ram's Head subdivision be granted.
A motion to second?
I'll second.
Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Next item on this evening's agenda is Dobie Public Access Waiver, a request by Dr. Gilbert Tiber, I'm sorry, and Mrs. Anna Doby for a public access waiver for lot U14-12, located off McKinney Road, and this is reviewed under section 19-4-2B, public access waiver. A little background on this, Maureen?
Certainly. The Dobies are represented by their attorney and by Richard Manthorn this evening, and they own four existing lots on McKinney Point Road. They are taking three contiguous lots and merging them into one lot in order to meet our current minimum lot size requirement. But all the lots, even merged, still are on a private road, so in order to become buildable, they need a public access waiver. This application was on the planning board agenda a few months ago, and there were some questions about the history of those lots and whether or not some kind of subdivision review had been generated at some point. The applicants hired an attorney who researched the issues, determined what the background of the creation of the lots were. He presented an argument to our town attorney, which our attorney has now accepted. The applicants have also scaled back their original request and are now asking for one public access waiver for the one lot that creates the three merged lots. Any questions?
No, but maybe some. Make a presentation, please.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. Good evening. I'll try to be brief about this because I know you have a long agenda, and I think this is a relatively simple request in front of you tonight. My name is Christopher Vaniotis. I'm a lawyer practicing in Portland, and I represent Dr. Tibor Doby and Mrs. Anna Doby. Mrs. Doby is actually the owner of record of this property. Neither of them can be here tonight. If they're home watching on TV, I say this with a certain amount of trepidation, but I think it's fair to say that the Dobies are elderly folks. Mr. Doby is 80 years old. Mrs. Doby hasn't told me her age. She volunteered her husband's age, but not her own. But they've reached the point in life where they are past retirement, and they have owned this land since 1966. Thanks, Maureen. And now feel that they need to do something with it. Their original thought had been that perhaps they would build a retirement home here, but they live elsewhere in Cape Elizabeth and are satisfied to continue to live where they are, and now would like to do something with this piece of land. Specifically, they'd like to be able to sell a building lot. By the way, Richard Manthorn is here with me tonight, and he can answer any technical questions we have as we go on. As Maureen indicated, as the town planner indicated, the Dobies first approached the town in August of this year, and at that point they were proposing to seek a public access waiver for two lots. One of them, the one described as lot 3 on this plan, and another made by combining lots 5, 6, and 7. Those lot numbers actually come off a very old subdivision plan that was never recorded in the Registry of Deeds. That proposal for the neighborhood dredged up some old history from the 1980s, and it was history that really brought back some rather unpleasant memories for the Dobies, I think, and also for the neighborhoods of a neighborhood dispute that occurred back in 1981 and 1982 concerning this property. That's something the Dobies don't want to relive, and that is really why they have decided at this point simply to ask for the public access waiver for one lot consisting of 3 acres made by combining lots 5, 6, and 7, as shown on that plan. So the good news is that there really is no need tonight to dig into the past to unearth that history. The other part of the good news is that since the town attorney has reviewed my lengthy letter about all the subdivision history and said in his view this is not a subdivision issue, assuming you accept that, then you don't have to deal with my lengthy letter and all the history about the subdivision statute and the Cape Elizabeth subdivision ordinance in that letter. So really what you have before you is, we suggest, a very simple and straightforward request. It's for a public access waiver for one lot. The lot will be 3 acres, well over the minimum lot size required in the zone. It will be a relatively wide and a relatively deep lot. In response to a concern expressed by one of the abutters, one of the neighbors, Mr. Yasawa, we have hired a wetlands consultant who has mapped the small RP2 wetland on the lower portion of the lot that's proposed for the public access waiver. The code enforcement officer has reviewed that. He was on the site with the wetlands consultant and agrees that that's an RP2 wetland and that under the Cape Elizabeth Ordinance. There is no setback required from it, but we have drawn a building envelope with a 25-foot setback from that RP2 wetland. And we're not here requesting a wetlands alteration permit. We don't need one. The purpose is to demonstrate to you that even with that small area of wetland on the lower portion of the lot, this is a buildable lot with plenty of room to place a home on it. The road is already there, so there's really no construction work to be done to create a new road for this public access waiver. It's been there for years. It serves some other properties on down the road as you go away from Two Lights Road. It serves the Yosselo property, which is the house in the middle of the two pieces that the Dobies own. The only changes that are proposed to the road will be 50 feet of paving at the entrance from Park Road as it comes off Two Lights Road, and that's what the ordinance requires. Also, some brush needed to be cleared to create adequate site distance at the corner of McKinney Point Road and Park Road, and that work has already been done. So the site distances shown on this revised plan reflect that that clearing has already occurred. Fire chief and the town engineer have reviewed this. The code enforcement officer has reviewed septic system design and found it satisfactory. And once again, the town attorney has reviewed the question of whether conveying this one lot would require subdivision approval and has rendered the opinion that it would not. So we suggest to you this is really a very simple one. It's a good size lot. It's a good building location. There's an existing road to serve it. And it's a simple, straightforward request for a public access waiver. Because the Dobies were once scheduled on the agenda back in September and then rescheduled twice, I believe, at the Dobies' request, the people in the neighborhood have had some opportunity to express comments to the board. There's a letter in your file, I believe, from Mr. Yosselo raising the question about the wetlands, and we've addressed that by identifying them and drawing the building envelope to exclude the wetlands. The letter that you received tonight appears to misunderstand the proposal because it talks about the request for two lots on McKinney Point Road, and once again, we amended that a month and a half or so ago, so this is a request at this point only for the one lot, the three-acre parcel. We suggest to the board that we think we've provided you with everything you need to know in order to pass on this application. Partly because of the history of this, the Dobies are anxious to get on with it. Even this relatively simple application has been somewhat stressful for them. We don't think a public hearing is necessary on this one, especially since the neighbors have had several months to submit any comments they might have wanted to submit to you. So we hope that based on the information we've provided and any questions you may have, that you would see fit not to hold the Dobies off until December, but to review this tonight and approve it tonight. I'm available for any questions you may have, and as to the technical details, Mr. Manthorne can certainly help with those.
Thank you. You didn't use the word simple in your presentation, did you?
Uncomplicated, perhaps?
Okay, that's all right.
Straightforward. Yeah. There were lots of very complicated issues when it was a two-lot proposal. But now that it no longer is a two-lot proposal, 3 acres that complies with all the zoning requirements on an existing private road, it, at least to us it seems relatively simple.
Our ordinance has in its definition section under simple the phrase apparently uncomplicated. Thank you very much. With that, open up for a discussion of the board members as how they would like to proceed, reminding you that we do have a request from some of the abutters for an opportunity to hold a public hearing. The issue before us is, again, a public access waiver. There are no subdivision issues, apparently, and there are no wetland alteration permit application issues. Any questions or comments?
Yeah, I have Mr. Park. A question regarding what we found on the podium tonight. Is this a request for a public hearing, or is it just to create a public hearing tonight? It appears they're trying to speak on this issue. as opposed to requesting the public hearing. It's maybe a matter of semantics, but I guess.
I don't know. I guess I don't know the intent of it.
Maureen, do you have any idea?
You do have some idea?
Yes. Mr. Dean is one of several people that's spoken to me about this, and this was his effort to show that there's support in the neighborhood for having a public hearing so they can formally comment on the proposal.
Thank you.
Excuse me. I don't know when I come in on this, but may I speak on the...
No, not at this time. This evening's meeting is not an official public hearing on this unless the board decides to open up the meeting for public comment. Even if it were open to public comment, it still wouldn't meet the requirements of proper notification for a public hearing and would therefore have some difficulties in meeting the typical requirements of a public hearing. Just so it's clear to the public this evening, a public access waiver does not require holding a public hearing. However, the planning board can, if it decides to elect to hold a public hearing on a public access waiver. And that's one of the items that we're discussing right now. This board does not grant building permits. Why don't we continue to discuss the issue that's before us? And I think through our discussion, you'll hear the opinions regarding the issue of a public hearing. Mr. Parkers?
I know for some reason, I guess I don't know enough about this. I haven't been out to the site to look at this or whatever. But it bothers me that the neighbors are concerned about a creation of a 3-acre lot on a road that already exists. There's got to be more to it than that. I, for one, would like to find out what it is.
Okay. Mr. Edson?
Mr. Chairman, there are a number of things. I was at the site this afternoon, late this afternoon, and although the application looks fairly straightforward, I agree with Mr. Parkhurst in that this board has typically been favorable towards public hearings, especially when we hear any comment or communication from the neighbors. It doesn't say what the nature of it is, and while we don't like to hold up an application, there are some things about the site, changing road width, for instance, which the town engineer recommends, but I would highly not recommend. The 50-foot paving of the first 50 feet, which I'm an adamant advocate of, usually for our public works people's benefit. In this instance, I'm not necessarily in favor of that. It's one of those sections in the town that just has a traditional look to it that park look. And if you've been there, you know that the turn into McKinney Point Road is dirt and gravel, and actually bump over some outcrop of ledge at that point. I think while it may not be real efficient when you come to try to plow that section, there's some character extreme. You lose a lot of character by requiring, number one, 18 feet in width, which there doesn't seem to be a real need for, and the 50 feet of pavement. There certainly is a significant wetland on the lot, whether it's a major portion of the lot or not, whether it's small. It's one of those pieces of wetland you don't have to, you don't go there and say, gee, I wouldn't know this was wetland if Ed had told me. It's very obvious. I guess at this point, I would favor a public hearing. It seems to be a pretty straightforward application, but I think there seems to be significant request for significant public input.
If for no other reason, so that the public understands specifically what the application is about versus what they may perceive.
I do have one technical question. That is why there are two sites for the septic system. Is it just to show that there's more than one location possible?
Well, that was done because originally there was going to be three lots there total. And since there's only the one lot down towards Oliviero, and this is one complete lot now. That's why there was two designs there to begin with, because that was going to be two lots. That was their thought in the beginning. And then that was changed.
There's no need for one lot to have more than one septic?
No.
Field?
Excuse me, Mr. Mansell.
But it's two designs, and I put them both on there.
Before you sit down, would you introduce yourself for the record?
Yes, I'm Richard Manthon. I'm a professional engineer, site evaluator, and land surveyor.
Thank you.
And I did the work on this project.
Okay. Any other comments?
One other question. The lot that remains, which apparently is not the subject of this application tonight, and maybe this isn't even appropriate to ask, but what is to become of that? Does it become a non-lot at some point, or what happens?
I think, Mr. Parkhurst, the answer to that is the Dobies just haven't made a decision about that yet. It will remain owned by the Dobies at this point, as it is now in its present configuration. At some point in the future, if they decide they want to take that one on, because that does present a lot of issues about what happened in the 1980s and whether it's grandfathered and whether there was a subdivision issue and so forth. So that one is just going to sit for the foreseeable future to be handled perhaps by them at some later time, perhaps by their heirs, perhaps by some kind of an accommodation in the neighborhood if some abutter thinks that that would add value to a lot. But at this point, they're not going forward and trying to get any kind of a permit for that lot.
Mr. Edson.
Another question dealing with the access road, Kinney Point Road. There seems to be two sets of pins, and looking through my bifocals down on the floor, I can't tell whether the southerly row of pins are property lines. Is McKinney Road, the private road itself, on the area that's under fee ownership?
Yes, it is. It's an easement over the Dobies property, where it passes over the Dobies property. And the same is actually true
of the lower.
What's called Sunny Point Road, which is the road on the lower side of the property.
Any other board comments, questions? Mr. Potter?
None.
Regarding the public access, the public hearing, I would hope that typically if the application is clear in its intent and it's right as a public access waiver, that we don't bring red herrings into the discussion regarding subdivision, since this isn't a subdivision. It's not a wetland alteration permit application, that we would treat it as a straightforward public access waiver. However, in the interest of caution and fairness, what I would like to do, my preference would be to hold a public hearing simply to, because of the history of this project, and simply to keep the record clear and public, to afford those members of the public an opportunity to come before the planning board and express their concerns regarding the public access waiver permit, and focus on the public access waiver permit, not dredge up things that are not pertinent to this particular application. With that, I guess, unless there are any other board comments, I would, I do have one other comment, is that with respect to the plan, the driveway turning radius has indicated 35-foot radius on each side of the driveway with a 20-foot driveway. I assume that's to accommodate the fire vehicles, and obviously that's a result of the road being as narrow as 14 feet. If there's any way of doing that without paving the entire 35-foot radius, that's a radius that is so large as to not even be found on many public streets. And it's just totally out of keeping with a typical residential neighborhood. It's the irony that when we are given public access waiver requests, that people's driveways turn into cul-de-sacs or turnarounds for emergency vehicles, although there may be other lots or other houses down the road. And I just, if there can be a gravel base place there that would be planted, and that the driveway itself, the paved area of the driveway, would look like a residential driveway, that would be more in keeping. With that, we have several motions potentially before the board. Would anyone like to offer up a motion regarding the public hearing? Mr. Parkhurst.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Dr. Tibor and Mrs. Anna Dobie for a public access waiver for one lot map U41, Lot 12, on McKinney Point Road be tabled to the regular December 20th, 1994, meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Have a motion, do I have a second?
A second.
Second, any discussion of the motion? I would just ask the applicant, would the 20th of December meeting, would you be able to be present for that meeting?
Yes, we would be.
Okay.
Mr. Manthorn, I shouldn't speak for Dick, but yes, I can be here, Dick can be as well.
All right, and we would expect that the public would be here as well and speaking to the issue at hand.
Mr. Chairman, just as a matter of discussion, I'm not advocating a sidewalk, but it might be helpful in lieu of an organized sidewalk, if members, it's an easily accessible site, you might want to drive down there and take a look at it.
Okay, I think that's a good suggestion. With that, we have a motion that's been seconded, all those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously.
The next one.
Thank you. Next item on this evening's agenda is Linnell Public Access Waiver. A request by William Linnell and Joyce Gutier for a revised public access waiver for one lot R2-21, located off Ocean House Road. This is reviewed under Section 19-4-2B, Public Access Waiver. Now, if there is something that's simple to come before the board, we trust this is it. Maureen, would you like to give us any additional background?
Mr. Linnell and Ms. Gauthier came to the board a few months ago and requested a public access waiver and a wetlands alteration permit for a driveway that extends from Ocean House Road behind Lyons Field to their lots. After the board approved the road and a wetlands alteration permit, the applicant approached the fire chief and requested that there might be a way to reduce the width of the approved driveway. Because this is only going to serve one or at the very most two lots, the fire chief has agreed that he would not have any objection to reducing the width of the driveway from 18 feet to 14 feet. For that reason, the applicant is requesting a public access waiver for the 14-foot width of the driveway. He is not returning for a wetlands alteration permit because he won't be changing the alteration of wetland area. He will at the very most be altering no more than he was supposed to before and will probably be altering a little bit less than before.
Thank you. Thank you.
She's good.
Would the applicant care to make a brief presentation?
My name is Steve Harding. I work for Oast Associates. We've been assisting Bill Linnell and Joyce Gauthier through this process. I think Maureen gave you a pretty concise summary of what we're proposing. Basically, it's the same project that you approved last June with a slightly narrower access drive from 18 feet to 14 feet. And if you have any specific questions, we can try to answer them now.
Any members of the board? Ms. Parkers?
Is the reason for the decrease in road width simply to save cost, save money building the road?
I'm Bill Linnell. We got some literature back from the Army Corps of Engineers, and I looked at it, and you could see that on the whole lot, it was such a small area that was conceivably buildable because of the setbacks. I thought that perhaps a 18-foot wide was a lot, and for what will essentially serve one house. And as a driveway, I looked around, and I know there are other places around which serve. You know, there's one road, a 14-foot road, which serves almost approximately two dozen houses in Cape Elizabeth. And I said, "Gee, this is only serving one house." And so I talked to the fire chief, and I talked to the town planner, and they said, I should go through this process. And to answer your question, finally, part of it is cost, because it seems, it's really expensive. And another consideration is that for us, our goal is to live in a sort of a country setting with the woods around. And it seems to me it would spoil that field to some extent to put an 18-foot wide road plus shoulders across the Lions Club field. To me, it would really interfere with the aesthetics, particularly when we're only serving one house. So it's a combination, really, of the cost and the aesthetics of the field, and then ultimately the need, because this is the only use that's contemplated up there. And we just felt that it's really excessive. I mean, you could get two fire trucks on the 18-foot wide. I mean, you could get two fire trucks on it. And it's a real straight shot. It's not like there are a lot of curves or anything like that.
Any other questions, board members?
Would this preclude a second lot that, or is 4 feet going to be acceptable at some point for a second lot?
I didn't hear anything that said it would preclude a second lot, though. Let the planner speak to that.
Any additional lot would have to come back to the board for a public access waiver. When I talked to the fire chief about this, under the subdivision ordinance, we define a road as serving three or more residences. So once you get to the road point, you're really talking a minimum of 18 feet wide. So I think there's a chance that you might be able to put another house on a 14-foot wide road, but nothing could happen without further review by the planning board and the fire chief.
Thank you. Any other questions? Just to be very clear about the cross-section of the road has a 14-foot wide gravel road. Is there any gravel shoulder beyond that?
It's a 14-foot wide gravel travelway, and then there's two-foot wide shoulders on both sides over gravel. It'd be a grassed loam and seed over
the same
gravel base.
Construction is the road base?
That's correct.
Okay. Any other questions of the board member? With that, I have a motion. Mr. Edsel?
A motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier are requesting revision to a previously granted public access waiver. Number two, the fire chief has revised his recommendation to reduce the width of the access road from 18 feet to 14 feet. Number three, the application substantially complies with public access requirements, section 9-4-2B. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of William Linnell and Joyce Gauthier for a public access waiver on lot R221, located off Ocean House Road, and be approved.
Second.
Second.
Could I just suggest an amendment to the motion that after Joyce Gauthier, it should be for a revision to a previously granted public access waiver? Or is it a public access waiver that we're granting?
Well, technically, under the ordinance, there's no opportunity to revise a public access waiver. Either you go with it or you get a new one.
Fair enough.
So it should say requesting. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm looking at the findings of fact.
Mm.
Okay. Motion, second, and comment. Any further discussion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Next item on this evening's agenda is Murray Drive public access waiver request by John Quirk for a revised public access waiver for one lot U22-26 located off Rand Road, reviewed under section 19-4-2B public access waiver.
Yeah, good evening. My name is John Quirk.
Just a minute. Could you wait until the planner takes a seat again?
Good
Any additional action required?
Well, this is very similar to the previous public access waiver where the board, a few months ago, granted a public access waiver for this lot, and the applicant has since decided to move their garage to the other side of the house, so all they want to do is shorten their driveway. They've left the original radius and turnaround exactly as previously designed, so there's just no opportunity in the ordinance for administrative amendments.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening, my name is John Quirk, and we're just looking to change the driveway from the west side to the east side.
I think that comes under simple.
It's that simple.
We all want to go home.
Must be a lot of surprise to butters. Thank you. Anything else?
I guess that's it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Boy, that would put engineers and landscape architects out of business that quick, if it were that simple.
I've been married to him for 35 years, and he's mad at your words.
Okay. Any questions by board members? I'll ask a brilliant question since I don't live too far down the street. The plan we have in front of us this evening, prepared by HI and EC Jordan, is a survey of existing conditions. There is no garage indicated on this plan.
No, that's for years down the line.
Okay. But the driveway will be there with no garage?
Yes.
Okay. From a design standpoint, it is much nicer to have the living spaces on the west side of the house so you can watch the sunsets and so forth. That's very nice. Any other questions or discussions? I have a motion. Mr. Edsel?
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, John Quirk is requesting a revision to a previously granted public access waiver. Number two, the proposed change does not alter the configuration of the emergency turnaround. Number three, the application substantially complies with public access waiver requirements, sections 19-4-2B. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of John Quirk for a public access waiver on lot U-22-20-26, located off Rand Road and Murray Drive, be approved.
Second.
Any discussion of the motion? Seeing none, all in favor, indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously.
Thank you.
Next item on this evening's agenda is the Caputa Club site plan, a request by the Caputa Club for site plan review of an addition to the front of the existing clubhouse located off Spurwink Avenue. This item is being reviewed under site plan review. And this item's this first issue to deal with this evening's meeting is site plan completeness. This item was presented before the planning board at our last workshop session as an introductory meeting. See the applicants here this evening. Maureen, any further comments?
This application is for a small addition to the existing building, but because the building was constructed prior to site plan review, the board is being asked tonight to grant full site plan review of the addition. It was not possible to treat this as an amendment to a previously approved subdivision since there was no previous approval.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening.
Mr. Mitchell.
My name is John Mitchell, Mitchell & Associates, representing Caputa Club. Jim DiOrio is here. Jim is the superintendent at the Caputa Club. The Caputa Club is proposing a 12 by 33 foot addition, two-story addition, off the northeast corner of the front of the clubhouse. The first level will contain three 330-gallon above-ground fuel oil tanks, surrounded by a three-foot-high foundation wall. The balance of the space on the first level will contain room or storage for empty bottle storage. The second level, or the upper level, will contain a walk-in freezer, which is currently on the exterior,
a additional storage for the kitchen, which is in the northeast corner of the building, and a small room to house tables and chairs. The new construction will also consist of a covered exterior walkway, which will replace an existing set of stairs, and a small storage room underneath the stairs. We plan on constructing a small raised planter in the front of the addition with some small shrubs. And there'll also be a relocation of one exterior light fixture from the current corner of the clubhouse out to the new corner of the addition.
We, as I mentioned during the workshop, we are requesting four waivers. Would you like me to go through those?
Yes, please, for the record.
Okay. The first is on the lot line dimension requirements, item D, which essentially is a boundary survey, and the reason we're requesting a waiver is because the total site is 188 acres, and we're only dealing with a very small portion of the site. The second waiver, item G, which is the side and rear setbacks. We have shown the front setback 278 feet from the right-of-way of Spurwink Avenue to the nearest corner of the addition. However, the side and rear setbacks would be, again, very difficult because of the size of the property. The third waiver would be on roads, curbs, bumpers, and sidewalks. We are not proposing any of those, therefore we are requesting a waiver. And the fourth is a waiver regarding signs, and we're not proposing any signs.
Thank you. First item, again, this is a two-step process. We first have to determine that the application is complete and then make a decision as to how we want to proceed from there. Any discussion on the completeness issue? Your motion?
Motion to the board to consider. It ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Papuda Club for a site plan review of an addition to the clubhouse located at 300 Spurwink Avenue be deemed complete.
Second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. At this point, we can move forward with the approval, if we so wish to do so.
That would be an assumption that the board chooses not to hold a public hearing.
Probably one question about that. Or do you want to wait for discussion?
No, go ahead.
The containment around the lower portion, about a 3-foot high wall, the only health issue that I can see in this is there any requirement from a building code perspective for where the doors, it looks like there are double doors going into that section, of any step up or step down, like there's a 4-inch step up for residential properties.
For a garage, yeah.
Mm. Is it, in other words, if you have 1,000 gallons of oil that go in there, is it built to contain that in there, or is that a straight walkout?
I'm going to ask Jim if he knows of any requirement or code pertaining to that.
I just noticed it's for storage, and if it, the two issues, I mean, it's a matter of convenience for you as well, but I mean, there is an issue of in a number of locations where leakage of 1,000 gallons of oil, you try to contain it in that location. Like Maureen, You have an answer?
I can't tell you whether or not there's a step down or not, but I can tell you that the code officer and the fire chief are reviewing that. And originally, the applicant had proposed three tanks. Because there's over, I think it's 660 gallons, they're being required to build a containment wall inside the building to separate two of the tanks from the third tank. So I don't know whether there's a step down, but the issue is being reviewed.
Maybe right in the basin and under the tanks itself, so. If
that wall does not have to be put in there, I check that out with the state, and there's no requirement for a wall separating those tanks.
There may be a local requirement due to the fire chief's review. I just want to be clear here. We're getting off areas that are a little explosive, so to speak, that come under the purview of the code enforcement officer.
That was my comment. If it's under their review, then I'll leave it up to them.
Yeah. I don't want anyone thinking that the planning board is going to be having the final say on those types of code compliances. Anything else, Mr. Edsel? Thank you. Any other discussion? Maureen raised the issue of whether or not the board wished to have a public hearing. Just like to poll the board, does anyone have any interest in a public hearing? Seeing none, we would like not to have one. With that, do I have a motion? Mr. Parkhurst.
Findings of fact. Number one, the Purputa Club is requesting review of an addition to the clubhouse located at 300 Spurwink Ave, which requires review under section 19-2-10 site plan review. Number two, the application substantially complies with the requirements for site plan review. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Purputa Club for site plan review of an addition to the clubhouse located at 300 Spurwink Ave be approved.
Second.
Second. Any discussion on the motion? I'd like to welcome Mr. Sherman. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Next item on this evening's agenda, and we're about 50 minutes ahead of schedule. I don't know if we're expecting any public, it's not a public hearing, but anyone that might be waiting until 8:40. If you're at home and you're waiting until 8:40, hop in the car and come on down. It's not a public hearing, but the meeting is open to the public. Last item on under other businesses, accessory dwelling unit amendments. Request by the town council to consider amendments allowing accessory dwelling units within single-family homes, section 19-4-9, zoning ordinance amendment. Maybe a bit of a simplification because we're already permitted under just different standards, if I'm not mistaken. Would you give us a little background on this, Maureen?
Sure.
A little more background.
The accessory dwelling unit provisions were referred to the planning board by the ordinance. They were prepared by the ordinance committee and referred to the planning board as an amendment to the zoning ordinance by the town council. The board held a public hearing last month, has proposed a number of changes to the original draft. Under the zoning ordinance, you now, once you've held a public hearing, you have the authority to either recommend these or recommend something else or formally oppose the attached provisions. At the last workshop, the board had discussed potentially identifying some reservations that you might have with any set of accessory dwelling unit amendments. And what I did try to do on page two is just in a bullet fashion list some of the issues that I had heard mentioned in the past. If the board is going to take that route and go with some kind of recommendation with some highlights or recommendations, you may want to take a look at that list and suggest any changes or any additions to it. What we had done originally is that the council had asked that the board forward their formal recommendation by November 1. There has been a request for a two-month extension, so if the board can get this in some fashion sent to the council by the end of this year, you would be within the time frame of the extension. Are there any questions?
And if we were to do it tonight, we'd be a month ahead of the deadline.
Well, what we had originally discussed is that with any any text recommendation from the to the council. The board usually sends a cover letter that just summarizes your feelings, and usually that cover letter is reviewed by the planning board chair. In this case, the cover letter could be reviewed by the entire board at the next workshop. There is one other thing I should point out, because it's, there have been some very minor additions that are based on the discussion of the planning board at the last workshop. There is, however, one addition that you have not discussed at all, and if you want to consult the actual draft, the new paragraph D has some text in italics, and there was a member of the public, a resident of Cape Elizabeth, who had expressed support for the idea that the existing building should look like a single-family building and then be allowed to come forward and ask for an accessory dwelling, which is then compatible with the look of a single-family dwelling. What happens if the original building never looked like a single-family building? So what I have done is I have added some language in here that goes to that issue, but you may want to take a look at that since you haven't seen it before.
Okay, thank you. At this point, I'd like to open it up for any further board discussion. Mr. Barkhurst?
I'll let someone else start first.
Had considerable public input. We had over 2 hours, I believe, with public input issues regarding property values, single-family zone.
I guess one of the things that might help for the people who are looking at this from home, we did have an addition to the public hearing last time at the board meeting, significant discussion at our last workshop. And at that workshop, Maureen was nice enough to give us a quick summary of some of the issues like this, some of the zoning ordinances like this in surrounding neighborhoods, and that might be of some use in terms of background for our discussion tonight, if you'd be willing to summarize them again.
And she's come prepared to.
From what I remember, I looked at some of the ordinances in nearby communities. Some of those communities I looked at were just because I happen to have those ordinances. Others are because they are what we call comparison communities, which we refer to in our comprehensive plan because they're like Cape Elizabeth in some ways. Starting with Cumberland, they have a provision, a specific provision in their ordinance which is called accessory apartments. They allow them as of right in any residential zone. So I remember you have to have at least a 500 square foot minimum size to the unit. In Falmouth, they also have a very explicit provision in their ordinance where they allow the conversion to an accessory dwelling unit in most of the zones in the town. It looked like it was approximately two-thirds of the land area of Falmouth where they're permitted. The areas where they're not permitted are basically, there is one residential zone, but mostly it's commercial zones where you tend to not want to see these things anyway. Neither one of those, as I remember, had much in terms of requirements on lot size. In Yarmouth, their ordinance does not have any specific provision for accessory dwelling units. It's a lot more implied, and their provision, their planner told me that essentially they feel it's allowed. There is one zone in town where it's specifically allowed as a conversion, but he felt that it's that you could just go and do it, and that you did not need zoning board approval. Let me go back to Cumberland for a minute, where I believe there you did need to get approval as a special exception, which was essentially a conditional use approval from the zoning board. you could have no more than one bedroom, and no more than 40% of the total living area of the building could be converted. They had a minimum lot size there of 20,000 square feet, at an absolute minimum, although it could be increased for plumbing code requirements. Their special exceptions are essentially the kind of things that you would see for any conditional use. You have to look at the impact on traffic, water pollution, on healthful conditions, compatibility with the neighborhood, noxious odors, environmental issues, and there was a requirement that it not depreciate economic value. I also looked at Freeport, and in Freeport, they allow single and two-family uses almost in every zone. And the only places where they did not mention two-family, and I'm assuming an accessory dwelling unit would be considered a two-family, is where they were trying to discourage single-family uses as well. So there were a couple of the business zones where they weren't really encouraging single-family zone, single-family uses, and therefore were not even mentioning two-family. And then I also looked at the South Portland ordinance, and again, Yarmouth, Freeport, and South Portland had no specific provision in their ordinance, whereas Falmouth and Cumberland had a very specific provision that said this is what you can and cannot do. And it looked like it was permitted, it could be interpreted as permitted as an accessory use. And I didn't follow up on how they handle it in that particular community, but it said that you could permit accessory uses to permitted uses, and in most of the zones, residential uses were permitted. You know, it looks like in most of the towns, there's some provision for it. The provision for treating it as a conditional use is relatively common. And there was usually some requirement on the size of the unit and some requirement on the lot size. Any questions?
Thank you, Maureen. Further discussion? Mr. Edsel?
Maureen, do you, in the paragraph number one, the last sentence states, the applicant shall also demonstrate compliance with the town sewer ordinance. Does that close entirely the loophole in the existing ordinance where, you don't understand the question?
Yes.
The difference between sewered and non-sewered. Does that fully close that loophole?
I think this deals with the whole issue of sanitary disposal in a much more consistent and rational fashion than the current language. The current language suggests that you need 15,000 square feet for sewer and a greater amount of lot size if you're on septic. However, it says, as approved through the plumbing code, what happens is that people can go through the plumbing code and get variances and waivers, and in fact get approval for a lot size that's less than 15,000 square feet. So while you would assume that someone on sewer would have the smaller lot size requirement, in fact it's possible for someone on septic to get the smaller lot size requirement. So what this does is this takes that whole thing out of this section. It's all dealt with very comprehensively in the sewage ordinance. Whether or not it does not fill the loophole of the state plumbing code.
But it says that if you apply for a permit through the state plumbing code, you still have to have 15,000 square foot minimum.
What it does now is it holds an accessory dwelling unit to the same standard of any other building in town. And the reality is that if you can get I believe the state building code was going to be dropping its minimum lot size even lower than 10, and I believe our requirement is you have to have at least 10,000 square feet. So in that sense, the local ordinance would be a little bit more restrictive. The reality is that if someone does apply for an accessory dwelling unit, there is an assumption by the code officer that there's going to be very little impact. It's going to be one additional person. At the most, what he's going to do is have the applicant certify that there's another space on the lot for a replacement system if the existing one fails. So there's no real check to see if the existing system can hold additional flows. And often, it's almost impossible to find the design of the existing system to begin with.
I guess the underlying, there are a number of things about this ordinance that makes it difficult to keep bringing this up from 1 month to the next, or twice a month. I, for one, and I sense other board members have a problem with this, the whole idea that there's public feedback dealing with accessory units, and they're becoming or creating multifamily structures where single-family homes were intended. There's a fairly clear recommendation, I won't call it a mandate, but it's an objective and recommendation of a comprehensive plan dealing with, this should revise the zoning ordinance to increase a homeowner's ability to create an accessory apartment unit. What I'm trying to weigh in my mind are the issues of enforceability. The new phrase that we enter in here, the accessory dwelling unit shall only be created where the main building has a single-family character and appearance, and that appearance and character is maintained. I don't know how enforceable that is. If I have a home that doesn't look like a single-family, my home looks like a barn, and I want, and I can create an accessory unit so inconspicuous that it never will be noticed. This ordinance says I can't do it because I don't start with a duck, so I can't make it look like a duck when I get done. I have a problem with that. The enforceability issue, we're trying to include the owner occupancy, and I think that's the intent. It says right in the comprehensive plan to increase a homeowner's ability to create an accessory apartment unit. And yet we're told legally, we don't know if that's enforceable. In other literature that we've read, I think written by Attorney Beniatis, who was here earlier, said don't put something in your ordinance you can't enforce. It's not good, but it's not good business to do that. And yet we're trying to do that. There are other parts of this that make that type of creation of unit more workable, and it certainly has its merits. I'm still torn with this. I don't have any answers. I know that we've reached a consensus on the 15,000 square foot minimum lot size to make it eligible for an accessory dwelling unit. It still seems to have no rational merit to it as a benchmark for eligibility.
It's significantly less than what's required now.
No, it's 50,000 required now.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's the house size that's that's smaller. Mm-hmm. Any other discussion? Just before you go ahead, Mr. Parks, I just want to point out that under item 2, you may already see this, but the 15,000 square feet is noted as 1,500 square feet.
1,500.
I mean the 1,500 square feet.
And while we're being picky, excuse me.
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, in number 3, second line, floor area of the structure, comma, is defined herein. I think structure was defined in the old ordinance, but I don't believe it's defined here.
In the current ordinance, we actually have a definition called floor area of the structure, and that was adopted with the shoreline zoning amendments.
I retract my comment.
Changes therein.
Mr. Parkers?
Just a couple of points I want to make. Mr. Retzel referenced the comprehensive plan, saying that there was a desire by some of the townspeople to want to be able to create an accessory dwelling unit in their homes for one reason or another. There's also, which I have brought up before, another part of the comprehensive plan where a vast majority of the townspeople really don't want to see any more apartments in the town of Cape Elizabeth. So they're sort of butting heads a little bit. Maureen brought up sort of summaries of the different towns, and I'm not trying to dispute anything, but I'd just like to sort of add something maybe. And we discussed this in the workshop. To me, an accessory use to a single-family home is not an apartment. That typically is a garage or some other outbuilding that is an accessory use to a single-family home. I don't see that as an accessory dwelling. And I don't think any of the ordinances she read were clear as to what it was. It's open to interpretation. And in the Falmouth zone, town of Falmouth in particular, there is one zone that these apparently are not allowed, and that seems to me that that one particular zone, if I'm not mistaken, is pretty much in between Martin's Point and on the water side of Route 88, or on either side of Route 88, which is probably the most comparable neighborhood that Falmouth has to most of the town of Cape Elizabeth. It's predominantly single-family homes of varying sizes, from very small to very large. But for some reason, the board in Falmouth chose not to allow that in one particular zone. I don't think I really wonder why, but it's certainly a good notion to consider. If we were to use that as some sort of model, then maybe we could possibly allow this in maybe all of the zones in town, with the exception of the Residence A zone, just to make it somewhat comparable. Let's see. I think that's all I have at this point in time. I'm also, with sort of closing comment here, I'm having a real hard time with this. And I, like a lot of the letter writers, have absolutely nothing against people creating an accessory dwelling in their home if it is truly to take care of some relative, whether it be in-law or what have you. However, I have a real problem with the people who have bought homes in this town, no matter where they are, thinking that they were buying a piece of property in a zone that was somewhat inviolate, that they weren't going to wake up next morning hear saws and hammers creating a rental unit next door to them over the next door neighbor's garage. And I cannot, in any good conscience or any conscience at all, you know, support anything that is going to sort of let the people of this town down in that regard. That's it.
Any other discussion? I don't know that there's a lot more to offer. We had some very powerful discussions at the public hearing regarding the issue of property values. And I believe our Mr. Parkhurst, who is involved in the real estate business, agrees with those notions that conversion of units for accessory dwelling units will generally tend to lower adjacent property values. That's certainly one item that weighs at the top. The other one is expectations. If one is moving into a single-family neighborhood, one suddenly finds out that, in essence, it's not specifically a single-family neighborhood, but that any house within that neighborhood is susceptible to conversion. On the other hand, any house in many neighborhoods is susceptible to perhaps a conversion for a home occupation, and any home, as I understand it, in a single-family neighborhood is essentially a rental unit. Anyone who owns a single-family home has every right to rent that house out to whomever they wish, including multi-persons, non-related households. That certainly happened in my neighborhood, and it has happened for well over a year. And has impacts, in my opinion, which are significantly greater than the impact, at least the physical impact, than the outside of a accessory dwelling unit. I've given the personal experience in the past of having a relative who was able to hold on to a house, not by necessarily developing an accessory dwelling unit, but by renting out part of the house to college students. and that was an effective way of dealing with a steeply escalating property tax burden when there was no appreciable increase in value in the house other than that due to the unrealistic real estate surge back in the mid-80s. Those values that were apparently in the mid-80s dropped dramatically since then. The other issue that Maureen brought up before is the issue of the board realizing that this is a proposal that's being passed forward to the council, and the council will presumably hold a public hearing on this matter. That regardless of our vote this evening, there still will exist within the town's ordinances a accessory dwelling unit provision, and that the opportunity that the planning board has here is to look with the council and to make suggestions to the council's proposed rewrite. Again, I will state that there is some question if this provision were to pass a council vote, the issue of the lot size is not related to any existing zoning in the town. There's no such thing as a 15,000 square foot zone. That this seems to be a lot size that is somewhat palatable because of existing lot sizes. And in my research, I'm unable to say that 15,000 is a number that is any different than 10 or 12,000, and can wonder if it's in fact a 15,000 square foot lot minimum size, whether this the intent of this provision is going to meet the need that it, at least the planning board has discussed, and that's in some cases to help elderly residents maintain their households or to seek a separate living quarters within a house where they may have assisted living with relatives. And we've certainly had correspondence to that effect that people, elderly residents, were looking to have the opportunity to stay in their house while their children moved in with them, but afforded the accessory unit afforded them the opportunity to live a separate lifestyle. With that, I guess I will, Mr. Edsel.
Before we entertain any motion, I just want to go back over a point that Mr. Parker's made, and I certainly understand your perspective. If the comp plan itself is misguided or is not a good recommendation and doesn't reflect what the survey of general opinion of residents of the town of Cape Elizabeth, not recommending this ordinance does not resolve the problems with the existing ordinance, nor does it negate the existing ordinance in any way. Nor does requiring a certain zone where accessory units are exempted, or creating one where it's allowed. I think I asked that question before, whether the ordinance committee discussed that or thought of developing that, and I think the answer was no. And I assume that means that the type of approach wouldn't be acceptable with a council to begin with. Maureen, you can correct me if I'm wrong there, but
I think, I'm still troubled with this myself, mainly because it goes against the grain of accepting accessory units. We can't enforce the owner occupancy issue, is my understanding. That's a key to the entire workability, as I see the comp plan intending. I guess enough discussion, might as well take it to the vote.
Mr. Chairman, if I can be heard.
Yes, Ms. McKay.
I guess I have a slightly different variation on this theme. I do take seriously the instructions in the comprehensive plan to provide for a variety of housing types in Cape Elizabeth, and it seems to me that the test really should be that we are not interested in totally changing the, or allowing the change of, the general character of single family neighborhoods, but if we can admit to having accessory units for relatives and caring for elderly people, and saying that that is not something which is going to unduly affect the character of the neighborhood, it seems to me that applying an objective standard, we could say, can we craft an exception for accessory uses that allows us to preserve the affect and appearance of the single-family neighborhood? Can we make the requirements of the square footage and whatever be tight enough so that we're not going to have excessive traffic, we're not going to have excessive parking lots out in front, we're not going to have anything that's going to unduly disturb the neighborhood other than an additional bedroom unit? I think it's important to keep in mind that we have now a multi-unit dwelling provision in the ordinance that in lots of ways seems to be broader than what it is that is under consideration now, or at least before us now. And I think when we really think about the possibility of allowing an accessory use for something that is no less than 300 and no more than 600 square feet, and we're talking about a land area that's 12,000 square feet or 15,000 square feet or whatever, on a 15,000 square foot lot, a 600 square foot apartment would be 4% of the land area. And I just don't think in terms of the kind of disruption to the neighborhood and the disruption to the tenants, shall we say, that we all hold dear, that really allowing accessory uses or continuing to allow accessory uses is going to disrupt us that much. I guess I really do think that we have tried to craft in here specific safeguards so that we should be able to find some way to allow this. This is not, it's just not, to my mind, that horrendously radical a departure. And I don't think, I know that different people have different conclusions that are drawn about whether the addition of an accessory unit would be a detriment to property values in the neighborhood, but my suspicion is I haven't certainly seen nothing that is a statistical survey of that, and I'm aware of the fact that there are appraisers who can conclude that that is a detriment or a detriment to property values and other appraisers who don't. It's not a foregone conclusion, it seems to me. So I would like to put in a real plug for having us consider this if we possibly can.
May I ask you a question? You spoke to, the issue of item number 8 regarding owner occupancy. In your opinion, is that a make or break with respect to this?
Not at all. I, for one, do not think that the requirement of an owner occupancy is something that can be enforceable. And to my mind, it's equivalent to, if I'm trying to measure the impact on the neighborhood of allowing this accessory unit, it really doesn't matter to me whether, I don't think that you ought to be able to carve that off as a separate condominium unit, but if the owner lives in it at the time that the accessory unit is created, and then for whatever reason that property changes hands and somebody else rents it out or whatever, I don't think that there's a way of enforcing the fact that the owner has to live there in order to make it an accessory use.
Thank you. Well, Mr. Wilcox.
But I know that there are different.
Some of the thoughts that Janet just mentioned, I think on the whole, the crafting of the new version of the ordinance has a certain aspect of balance in that it has made creation of an accessory dwelling unit accessible to more people, but has simultaneously downsized the number of cars, dramatically downsized the size and the impact of the actual physical construction that would be allowed to take place. It seems to me as though those things sort of balance each other out, but the aspect of the new ordinance, I think, that is most important to me, especially following the concerns which were expressed by people who came last month to speak. Our old ordinance merely says that you do something that's compatible, whereas this new proposal has been a great effort to give the Board of Zoning Appeals something that is much more just concrete that they can use to evaluate proposals. And to me, just as at the matter of at the very simple, if I say level, this is a better ordinance than what we have now. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think is the most important aspect to it.
Just to pick up on that, it would seem that the original ordinance, the intent, or at least as we've heard historically, the intent of the original ordinance was to allow people with very large houses to somehow divide them into smaller components to make them more affordable. And those were very large components. What was the minimum?
2,500
square feet. And in this case, this is going, I think, straight to the issue in the comprehensive plan, or the intent is, with a gaping loophole of item 8 as to whether owner occupancy is enforceable. I guess the other thing to always keep in mind is that what we're doing again is referring this to the council, and there's continued opportunity for public input. There's nothing that's here that isn't already essentially on the books. With that, if there's no further discussion, look for a motion.
I guess before, could I ask one more question? It was
certainly
represented earlier that we had agreed on the square footage of 15,000 for the lot. Is that, I guess I for one would still like to see that reduced to something more like 12,000 to be more representative of a floor which would be a realistic floor for being able to add on to without undue impact to the neighborhood. I think 10,000 is probably too low, and the 12,000 is a more realistic number. But I don't know whether everybody else is happy with 15 or not.
Just to pick up on that comment, I don't know that there was ever agreement. I think in football it's called punting. That it was something that became a circular discussion, and we left the room at 15,000, and the circle was continuing to spin as we left. Let me ask Maureen a question before we continue with that discussion. If one were to come before the Zoning Board of Appeals for a conditional use permit for an accessory dwelling unit and could demonstrate that they had elderly parents in health care or otherwise living in their home, and there was a need for an accessory dwelling unit, and they lived on a 14,000 square foot lot, would a 15,000 square foot minimum be something that could be appealed as a variance?
I would want to double check on that, but I believe that the zoning board does not have the authority to reduce lot sizes.
That's right. Well, I think everyone knows my opinion on this. I certainly haven't seen anything that's different between 12,000 and 15,000. If there was something in our ordinance that talked about a 15,000 square foot lot, I'd be very comfortable in dealing with a 15,000 square foot lot. I don't have any issue of reducing it to 12,000. Any other board members that would like to comment?
Well, our resident C zone talks about a 20,000 square foot lot, is it correct?
That's correct. That's the minimum lot.
I'd be all in favor of raising it to 20,000 square feet. Okay.
So we have two 15s and one, two 12s and one 20. Mr. Edsel?
I'd rather see it reduced to 12.
Okay. Mr. Wilcox? Mr. Carter?
I'd like to see it reduced to 12.
Okay. We need to make a formal vote on that. Would anyone care to make a motion regarding the square foot's minimum lot size? No, we have a real disadvantage here.
Should we do that, or shall we just...
We just amend the, make a
vote of
amendment. Okay.
Yeah.
And the motion, I think.
I thought Mr. Edsel might find a conflict, and I'd have to oppose.
Could we have a little more discussion about Mr. Edsel's first point on, or one of Mr. Edsel's first points on the main building, which already has a single-family character and appearance? I guess I didn't read that exactly the same way that he did, although I suppose there are current residences in Cape Elizabeth. I mean, I don't know where I'm going with this, actually. I liked the suggestion when I first saw it in italics, but if it is going to be interpreted narrowly, perhaps we would be better off to strike the italics and simply keep it the way we've had it before, building in the other requirements that make the appearance of a single-family dwelling there at the end, if not at the beginning.
Could you speak to that just a little bit more and just clarify? Because this clearly says that if your house doesn't look like a single-family house, then you can't.
To start with, you're dead.
Yeah, and this really is at the discretion of the zoning board. All of this is at the discretion of the zoning board. And, you know, what it's going to do is it's going to give the board a hook if they're looking for one and are willing to use it. And I would assume it would be used only on those extreme cases. I would think that, and again, you know, I'm not on the zoning board. I can't tell you how they're going to behave, but I guess I would look at number six and where it talks a little bit more about the exterior appearance. I would think that if a homeowner could argue that they do have a distinctive front entrance, it's going to be really hard, except in the extreme examples, to exclude a home because the language we have here is still very vague. If we had some of the backup that we have in the proposed town center zone where there's actual drawings and examples of what looks like a single-family home. But this, you know, number six talks about architectural style of the structure. I would think if you were in a neighborhood and it's full of single-family homes and your house looks just like all the other homes, I'm not sure how you could argue that it wasn't a single-family style.
Mm-hmm.
In the odd case where you have a home that's distinctly different, it doesn't have a front entrance, in that case, you know, I assume that if they were so inclined, the zoning board could use this and say, well, you don't have a single family character to begin with, and therefore you can't apply to convert. Yes, it could be used that way.
But I guess in terms of impact on the neighborhood, the original structure is already there with the impact. So I think it's important to point out that number six that you're referring to is number six on the conditional use standards, and that in addition to the particular ordinance that we're talking about here, any proposed accessory use would also have to meet those six standards as well.
Right.
So I guess I would be in favor of striking this the italicized language, because as I look at number six, it does say enough to satisfy me, I suppose, that the design and external appearance of any proposed building will constitute an attractive and compatible addition to the neighborhood, although it need not have a similar design, appearance, or architecture.
Mr. Chairman,
Mr.
Just by example, I would try to bring in a reference to that, and I'll use structures that were used in communication to the board. I think there are a couple of buildings or homes on Bowery Beach Road that referred to as looking like duplexes. They are mirrored side-by-side images of each other structurally, and it would. Could those be construed to be not of single-family character and appearance? So, you know, are we aiming this at certain structures in the community? I made the reference to a barn, just trying to use a more simple comparison. Using those same structures, would paragraph 6 fully implement the wishes of the ordinance? And all the other parts, you know, 300 to 600 square foot per unit, 15,000 square foot, 12,000 square foot lot now. I know what that sentence is trying to say. I'm not sure that that is.
It says two things to me, if I can just interrupt for a minute. It says that. I mean, literally read, it says that if one doesn't have a house that looks like a single-family house, you're not going to get approval for a conditional use permit. And on the other hand, it could be extrapolated that if your house doesn't look like a single-family house and you do get a permit, then you may have to retrofit the existing architecture to look like a single-family house. Critical issue here, I think, is single-family, regardless of what the original architecture looks like. I mean, there, for example, there are many large, older houses in every city in the state that were originally single-family houses that had the main door, that now are so large that they've all been converted to apartments, and except for all of the exterior stairways and the 12 electric meters on the side, for all practical appearances at the street front, still look like very large single-family homes. I'm concerned that a zoning board might construe that, gee, that's a big house and it has a door on the side already. Maybe it doesn't look like a single-family house because it's so large and it is so prototypical of multifamily houses. I think the language is confusing, and I think as long as it's clear that what we're talking about is single-family homes to start with, regardless of the architectural character, but when those are converted, we want them to continue to look like single-family homes. I think that was the reason this was brought in, because what if they don't look like single-family homes to start with? Is it reasonable to expect that they are going to look like single-family homes when they're converted?
My question is, are you advocating removing the italicized, the italics in paragraph D? Or?
Yes, but in terms of purpose and intent, I would say that the intent is to, as much as practical, to continue a single-family appearance.
But I think that's what it says in paragraph six on the second page.
I agree.
So we'll strike it.
The entire sentence?
Just the italicized on page one.
I can read you what was originally there.
Yeah, would you do that?
Oh, yes, that would help.
September 22nd.
What you could replace it with, which is what was there before, is accessory dwelling units shall only be created where the single-family character of the main building is maintained.
Hmm. That assumes that there's originally...
Yes.
And I think... I guess I feel more comfortable with the original language.
Yeah, I do too. So there's another amendment. Any other discussion? Yes, ma'am.
In paragraph six, second sentence, we say any exterior alteration shall preserve the primary front entrance. I suppose it's possible somewhere in Cape Elizabeth that the primary entrance is not in the front. I mean, I just propose striking front unless, I mean, the primary entrance is the primary entrance.
What paragraph are you in?
Six. Fifth line down. It's not a big point, it just...
I know exactly where we call it unloading the house. In other words, the elevation of the house is going down sideways, and you unload it into a narrow lot,
mm-hmm.
and there are several of those in the town where the front door is actually faces the sideline.
Mm-hmm. That becomes the front of the house, then.
It's always the front of the house, yeah. But it's not the...
Even if the main entranceway is on the side, that becomes the front of the house, unless you're talking about relation
yes,
to the street.
I think that takes care of it.
Yeah, I don't have a big problem with that. So keep it.
Would it be appropriate to put front entrance in italics or quotes? Or
no.
Use the word formal?
Well, the primary entrance would be by definition. I mean, if it's by definition,
let me give you a classic example, and all ordinances will be plagued by this problem, is that someone comes in our house. There are no more primary front entrances. It doesn't exist in a bedroom community. There's a formal front door that's as ceremonial as a living room in most cases, and everyone uses the breezeway or the family room entrance between the garage and the house in the typical single-family house in Cape Elizabeth. So if one wanted to come in and convert and add a second entrance to the front of the house, they could simply argue that the main entrance to the house is the family room door.
And that the front door is only for hanging Christmas trees.
That's exactly right.
So perhaps formal is the better suggestion, if that's what you mean.
Christmas.
So we just change primary formal entrance?
Mm-hmm.
We would need a definition for that in the ordinance, formal entrance.
Or maybe we could have a definition for primary entrance that would be useful.
Getting information here.
Yeah, I agree.
Wouldn't you rather say formal front entrance?
The most expensive doorway unit.
Formal front entrance?
Formal front entrance, anyone have a problem with that?
The one thing I keep thinking of, and I've thought about this before, not everyone has a house that has a main body, an L, and a garage. I mean, a lot of people do, I do, we use our breezeway entrance, if you will, as the main way to get in the house. But not everyone does. There's a lot of houses that were built prior to that era where L's and, or breezeways, or however you want to phrase it, came into play. There's a lot of Victorian boxes out there, or colonial boxes, however you want to, you know, look at it.
I mean, a typical colonial box has a, either a center or a front door. If it's a Greek revival, the house is turned 90 degrees and there's still a front door, but it's on the gable end of the house in many cases. I think, except for listing every type of entrance, I think the intent is understandable here. If you're telling me that, you're probably going to tell me that there are people in Cape Elizabeth that don't put sealer on their driveways every year.
I suspect there are.
I guess the only thing we haven't discussed, I'm happy to make a motion, but I don't know where we are in terms of owner-occupied in number 8.
Any discussion on number 8?
My suggestion would be just to put a period after in the same ownership and delete and be owner-occupied.
Hey, can I ask a question? Has it been definitively answered that that is totally unenforceable? Or has it just been, an opinion has been rendered that it may be unenforceable?
Second.
The second one? It may be unenforceable. You're saying that it hasn't been tested in the courts yet?
Right. Until that happens, I think we should leave that in there and let someone take us to court. Let them spend the money instead of leaving the door wide open now to make it as difficult as we can.
Mr. Edsel?
I think it would be my opinion to leave it in, even though I think it's a key issue that I have a problem with. One of the few things I'd leave up to the council to decide. I mean, they are the final say. If they want to leave there, I'm sure we'll understand the issue of owner occupancy and enforceability. If they choose to leave in the ordinance reference to that, then so be it.
Any other discussion? I think I would agree. I put a lot of, if this language is lost, I think the intent of the ordinance should state that it's primarily for the purpose, even if it's specifically can't be enforced. One of the issues that I've heard addressed or raised is the issue of impact on neighborhoods and property values. Is there any reason, we haven't discussed this before, but I'm thinking, is there any reason to give this a trial test period, that the ordinance becomes active for a year, and at the end of 1 year that the council would review the impact that it's had, and at that time could have an opportunity to reconsider it? I believe we've done that with other...
Like sunset provision?
Yeah, sunset provision, exactly.
It's an interesting suggestion. I guess I'd be interested more in considering it if we'd never had an accessory use provision in the ordinance before, but since we already have one and this is a better provision in lots of ways, I guess I don't see the particular need for it here.
Okay. Any discussion on the items that Maureen raised earlier with respect to concerns that we had that may be placed in a draft to the, an attachment letter to the council? Item 1 is the applicability of conversions in all residential neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth. The issue there is that it does apply to all neighborhoods.
As it stands now.
Any discussion on that item?
Is the question for, are we going to be making up a letter at our next workshop or accompany our recommendation, whatever that may be?
Well, we have two opportunities. We could either do that now, we could draft the meat of that letter, so to speak, by identifying these items. And the issue is obviously how soon we get this off to the council, or if you feel that it's necessary to take this to another workshop, we can draft a letter at a workshop.
I think in just bullet form, the board can suggest items that would be included in the letter, and the chair, with the help of the planner, craft that letter. I don't know that we need to hold it up for another month.
I agree.
Then we have several items here. The next one is a legal defensibility of owner occupancy requirement. We've discussed that at some length.
I think it's fair to say that lawyers have just come to different conclusions about them. There's no definitive statement.
Lot size restrictions. We have a potential amendment to 12,000 square feet, but I think that's still a good item to place. And I have after that the issue of protection of property values. Because of the very strong public concern raised in that area.
That's included in number four in the conditional use standard.
It's included where?
Number four of the standard conditional use standard says the proposed use will not adversely affect the value of adjacent properties. The zoning board has to find that in order to approve a proposed accessory unit.
But I think the greater concern is that by having this provision in the ordinance, that it potentially lowers the property values within the entire neighborhood. I don't know that actually one unit has to be developed, but there's a potential for lowering property values as a result of the greater opportunity for use of this provision.
I think it's an issue worthy of mentioning in the letter to the council. Historically, it has been easy to find an appraiser to advocate both positions, and usually that's what happens. One or two appraisers for both positions are brought in. And so it's not something, and I don't know of another way to resolve that issue other than using real estate appraisers or real estate brokers. But it's not a benchmark by which I don't think decisions have been made in the past.
I believe there was discussion, too, about impacts on municipal services as part of the conditional use standard. I don't think that we saw any significant impacts there. Okay. Any other items? Any further discussion? Anything you'd like to add, Marie? I have a motion.
Can I ask one more question before we get to that? Are we restricting this to a one-bedroom situation?
Technically not.
The reason I bring this up, it's come to my attention through people that work in the school system. Apparently our, let's see how to phrase this, our school system is such and is so well and equipped for special needs, children, et cetera, that they have noticed a very definite influx of families or single parents with a child moving to town to especially take advantage of that. Mm-hmm. And it seems that probably maybe 7 out of 10 times or 8 out of 10 times the people are renting as opposed to purchasing. So consequently, they're not contributing their fair share to the tax rolls. Mm-hmm. I can see this possibly opening that up a little bit further, so it would have an impact on municipal services, if you will.
I think one could easily argue that this provision doesn't, at least apparently, accommodate that type of provision, that there's adequate space for special needs people in addition to parents.
Okay,
perhaps there is, but...
I would also say that historically, and I think that, of course, it would say that tenants have always been considered to
unless there is rent control in place, to contribute their fair share to taxes.
In my experience, in some communities, I felt I was giving more than my fair share.
Well, only when taxes go up on that particular piece of property once the unit is created. Otherwise, they're not contributing anything.
Their rent is paying a portion of the property tax on the property.
Otherwise, would still have to be paid by the single-family homeowner.
They're still contributing something by...
Okay, I would just like to have that possibly be added to the...
I guess I'm going to have, I as one board member would have a special concern about raising one aspect of the population regardless of this ordinance. If this community offers, at the same cost of all other communities, a far superior special needs program in its schools, I think people would come regardless of the types of, they could at the same time move into a single-family home and rent the single-family home, and it could be four people in a single-family home. If this community gave away free turkeys five times a week, people enjoy eating turkeys would find a way to move into this community. I don't mean to trivialize your concern. I guess the other question I would say then, that if that's the case, why aren't a lot of families fleeing because of the lack of computers in the school? I don't know how to, I that's a hard one for me to rest on this provision.
For the poor physical condition of our school.
Do the other board members wish to add that to the list of concerns?
No, prefer not to.
With that, do I have a motion? And I'm reminded that Ms. McKay cannot offer a motion because she's
right.
Not. I feel like...
Mr. Chairman, may I make a suggestion?
Mr. Cobb.
Where I was unable to attend the last meeting when the public hearing was held and the public had an opportunity to make their comments, which some of which I'm sure influenced the board, I have no objection and would step down if the chair wishes to avoid.
I'll ask the planner, is there any problem with that? Okay. Your offer is graciously accepted. With that, I'll ask, this is not rehearsed, pre-planned, this is, boy, does this look wired.
I'd be more than happy to make a motion, and thank you very much for your graciousness, Mr. Cotter.
Excuse me, the planner has reminded me that before you do that, I will appoint you as a voting member.
Thank you. Motion for the board to consider is that be it ordered that based on the comments and the facts presented, the proposed accessory dwelling unit revisions to the zoning ordinance be recommended to the town council for adoption as stated in the November the 10th draft with the following changes: that in section 19-4-7D, the third sentence beginning with accessory dwelling units be revised to read, accessory dwelling units shall only be created where the single family character of the main building is maintained. That in D sub 1, the first sentence reads, a lot must have a minimum of 12,000 square feet to be eligible for the addition of an accessory dwelling unit to an existing single family home. That in sub 2, that 15,000 square feet be identified by a comma instead of a period between the 1 and the 5.
1,500?
1,500, I'm sorry, yes, thank you. That the typo be cleaned up in number 5 so that parking areas reads properly. That in subparagraph 6, the second sentence reads, any exterior alteration shall preserve the formal front entrance rather than the primary front entrance, change primary to formal. And that there be no other changes except for space between conditional and use in paragraph 8.
Is it necessary to include these items?
I like that word.
That's just procedures. Okay, we have a motion, second. Ms. Wilcox is seconded. Any further discussion?
Just a question, how does the recommended amendment in paragraph D differ from the original? Ms. McKay?
The pre this version?
Are you referring to accessory dwelling units shall only be created where?
Where the main building is maintained is how it's recommended.
My understanding, it was the original language that was placed at the origin.
Right, what Ms. McKay read was the October 12th language.
Okay, that's fine.
Any further discussion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. All opposed? Several for and one against. Four.
My vote was four.
Excuse me?
My vote was four. I was slow getting my hand up.
Oh, it was.
Unanimous.
Oh, wow. Wait till we tell you about Shore Road. Okay, last item.
So are we mentioning, excuse me, just for clarification, in the cover letter, are we mentioning three areas of concern?
I have one, two, three, four, five. Applicability of conversions in residential neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth, potential for fundamentally altering the character of a single-family neighborhood, the legal defensibility of the owner occupancy requirement, the possibility of arbitrariness of lot size, although we reduced it, we still felt that that was a number that was quite manageable, and the issue or pointing out the concern about property values at the public hearings.
I guess I wondered whether it was important to mention number one, since we had decided that it was applying to all residential neighborhoods, but I don't have a strong feeling about it.
Does the board have any preference?
No real preference.
Just to remind, the discussion originally was that, in fairness, this should be applicable to all neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. And that's implied in the language that's been proposed. So there are now four items. Again, last item on this evening's agenda that I've added under other businesses, just a reminder that there is a site walk scheduled for the 19th, the Saturday at 9 o'clock a.m., and people are past the park in Mr. Perez's yard. That's one of the big gravel on it.
With the what?
What's his address? I don't know exactly where his house is.
It's a gray house with red trim.
Sort of right in the middle of the road.
I believe it's marked on the map with his name on a lot.
Okay. But there's a quite a wide curving gravel driveway that goes up into his property with a gate.
And there's a barn up
yeah,
beyond that?
Yes.
Yeah. But he lives not, I mean,
in the house, right?
I don't know. The other thing that I would, if the applicant could provide a copy of a topographic plan, USGS plan. I believe you brought that to the meeting because Xerox is a section of the property.
You are here.
Since there isn't going to be as many markers as I thought there would be. And again, for the public, this is not yet a formal application before the board. And you have notified the abutters. Have the abutters been notified of the walk?
There has been no notice sent out to notify them of the sidewalk. We've never done that.
Okay.
You know, certainly I can mail something out tomorrow if that's the wish of the board.
How does the board feel about this?
The issue of notifying all abutters?
That there is a site walk scheduled. Again, it's unusual in that it's not a formal application.
We don't have a list of abutters in the formal application yet.
Wouldn't we have to create the list of abutters?
No, we wouldn't, because we have been sending out notices to the two abutters as part of the workshop, and we've just been using an all-inclusive list. We've looked at every, you know, we've just taken the whole chunk of property, when in doubt, we've sent the notice.
How many are we talking about? What's the cost?
I think we're talking 50. I'd have to double check that. You know, the other thing to keep in mind is you know, the board could conceivably be holding another workshop, another site walk, once a formal application is here. If anyone did show up, Certainly, it's always been the board's position that they can attend the site walk because it, in fact, is a public meeting of the board.
I certainly don't have any objection to having anybody who wants to show up and come along, but I don't, by the same token, see any particular reason to vary from our usual...
We normally do not.
If we normally don't invite, why particularly would invite?
They're always invited, but are they not invited?
They're always invited. We never send notices, but one of the reasons we don't send notices is because the board usually schedules a site walk after the application is deemed complete, so abutters will be notified as soon as the application comes in that you've begun to review it, and the theory is that if they're interested, they're watching the meeting, we schedule the site walk at the meeting, and they know about it.
It would seem consistent that if we're notifying abutters of the workshop session, that is, this in a way is another workshop...
I agree.
...session, that we would...
The cost, I think we should do it.
...consistently notify them, particularly if there's any chance that we wouldn't have another site walk, given, I don't know what the schedule of the application would be. I would be in favor of notifying the abutters.
I think also it would be recommended to, recommendable, wear blaze orange.
I'm going to try to, I haven't been able to get in contact, I'm going to see if we can get some of those orange vests from the...
If we could, I don't have, I just haven't noticed, I live on 303 Mitchell Road, and a bow hunter got out of his truck across the street from my house and headed in the woods this afternoon. And so I'm sure, as small as the conservation areas behind Stonegate, there must be more than one on a lot this time.
Okay. Any other items for discussion?
I think maybe a suggestion. You may want to have the site walk after hunting season's over.
Too late now.
I, for one, am not fully equipped with, I have all the blaze stuff, I guess, somewhere in my house, but I'm not really excited about going out in the woods right now.
Any other members of the board that can...
Does Juan have his property posted?
I think it's a concern, but, and I don't have any, I got rid of my blaze orange 15 years ago, I guess, that I know of.
Hunting season ends the end of November. I guess the concern, the only reason and the unusual aspect of this is that it's a large project, and it's most likely going to come to us during some months when we're, the snow cover and the ice and so forth isn't going to give us a very good representation of what's there. And we're using this opportunity of fair weather to visit the site.
I think we should go.
I think if we sing hiking songs and so forth.
Get a couple cowbells with you.
Right.
We can drive the deer for them.